earlier. I'm working in Telecom Interactive as a software developer. So I've been working in Drupal since 2012. I started in Drupal 6, but I'm gradually moving forward to Drupal 8. So I sometimes blog about stuff related to Drupal or anything in my WordPress site. So what we'll be going to, so what today is, what is Headless Drupal, when and why to use Headless Drupal, the RESTful web services in Drupal 8, and how to create a RESTful API in Drupal, since the stuff is in the Drupal core. And I'll try to give you a small demo that I did in my local after that. So what is Headless Drupal? Basically, it's a Drupal website without itself. The head has been cut off, and we just have the body of the headless Drupal site. So what happens when you visit a Drupal website? You are visited by a web page which is served by Drupal. And Drupal is nothing but just a head. The logo says it all, it's just a head. So if you take that head away, we have nothing from Drupal. And I've heard it more times in the Drupal front end sucks a lot. Though it's improved in Drupal 8, but the front end moves very fast whether Drupal likes it or not. With the evolution of many front end frameworks like Node.js or Angular or Backbone, it's pretty hard for Drupal to keep up for the Drupal front end developer to keep up with the pace of the front end code. So what's the solution here? We decouple the Drupal backend from the front end. By decoupling, it means that the backend doesn't have any relation or any connection with the front end. It's just providing its services via its data to the front end, and the front end is just consuming it and displaying it. So Drupal have nothing to do what's going on in the front end. So in a more technical way, when Drupal gets an HTTP request, so when you hit www.drupal.org, which is a Drupal site, so it responds with a HTML page with the user views in its web browser. The theme layer resides in Drupal. The theming is done using Drupal has a very good theme layer, but as I said, the front end is not. But there is no front end framework involved in this scenario. We are not using any frameworks like Angular to display the data or anything. But what if we remove the middle layer? Is the theme layer. So we remove the front end completely. We are not using anything in the Drupal front end, whether it's panels or views or any page, we are not using it. So Drupal will be only responsible for holding the data and the users, content or terms, this is that. So we replace the front end that the user sees with a front end framework like languages or packages or Node.js. So Drupal, as I said, Drupal is just used as a content repository to hold the contents, nothing else. It has nothing to do with the front-end thing. And what it does is just serve the contents with the JSON view or XML or HLJSON using REST services. So this is the manifesto that was provided when the term Drupal was defined. So these are the exact terms. Like what was in the manifesto. So first was we want Drupal to be preferred back-end content management system for designers and front-end developers. So Drupal, as I said, Drupal has evolved a lot from being just a blogging website to more for becoming a framework now. It's not just for blogging, you can timeline it using it. It's big. We believe that Drupal's main strength lies the power and flexibility in its backend. Primary value to users is its ability to architect and display complex content models. So what does it mean that the Drupal's main strength and power is its flexibility that it provides by which the architects or the developers can handle the complicated data and serve it to the users in a more simple way. Drupal is like that's wrong. So thirdly, we believe that client-side front-end framework are the future of the web, which is true. Like the backend developer is like the base guitarist in the band. No one cares about it. The front-end is the future. Like even if you see video.com, it's gone headless. Or Lula.com, it's gone headless. Because the front-end is like the interactive way of showing the data. It's like the data matters a lot to the developers, to the organizations, and to the users, everyone. It's critically important for Drupal to be service oriented first, not HTML oriented first, or address systems irrelevant. So it's like it's service oriented, service first, then front end. So what are the benefits of having a Drupal system? First is built in for one, but you can use it in many cases, like if you have a Drupal Gigabit website. You can use it in an Android app, you can use it in an iOS app, you can use it in a smart TV app or some front-end powered website. It doesn't matter because what it does is just providing a URL, an API, and it's just giving the data with it. It doesn't matter like what in the front-end, what's consuming it, it doesn't matter.
How we can use iOS
app? Sorry?
How we can use iOS app and Android app?
iOS? We cannot use it in Drupal. Like what I'm saying is, Drupal, in general, what happens, like Drupal is providing you with an API URL. That API URL will give a JSON output or XML output of the contents or of the request that you're giving. Like say you want a list of articles. So it will give a JSON output of the list of articles. And the Android app can just consume the data, just hit the URL and read the JSON and show it in its app. So it's the URL will be same for any front-end thing. Upgrading the front-end will not require any back-end change. Similarly, upgrading the back-end will not touch the front-end. So whenever like we are upgrading the front-end thing, we are upgrading the Android app, like we are upgrading an Android app from version 2 to version 3. So in the, like, since the data is same, what we are going to show that is same, that's not changing. So the backend thing, the backend development will be very less. It doesn't like matter like similarly, if you are changing some backend, you are changing some data structure for a content type. So the frontend will not be affected by it. But in this case, we need to take care the API URL that we have created should be saved. That's the only important thing that we need to take care of while upgrading the backend. Let's learn some Drupal expertise and the front end is detached. So, yes, so you don't need to be a Drupal developer when you're working in a clickable system. So, the front end thing. So, the front end thing, anyone who knows anything about like simple thing about the angular or a node.js developer can work in a Drupal project. It doesn't matter whether you know Drupal how to create contents or create presentation, it doesn't matter. You just have to know the basics of this certain thing. But yes, when there are calls, there will be problems, it will be complete. It will be difficult to debug. Difficult to debug in sense if the front end is not showing the data, it's very hard to find from where the error is arise, from where it's wrong. Like for example, few years back, like I was trying in a website, so everything was working fine. So the API URL is working fine, the JSON output is coming fine, the Angular code that I've written that also looks fine, but I'm not getting any. I'm getting a blank page. And after nearly spending a day, I realized like I got no link. When the host application, this is the Drupal web application, it's in the server and the Angular app application is a different server, we need to enable something called POS, cross origin resource services, which helps the connection between the two. So yeah, it's pretty difficult to debug whenever there is some situation error. Drupal also practice people to really scratch. Like Drupal has many functionalities like Facebook logging, the lightbox, motor pop-up, social media sharing, slideshows. So these are like few slideshows. We have products for that in Drupal front end. But when you have a debuggable system, we are not able to have this functionalities all by itself. So these things have to be built from scratch for the front end. Minimum read size requires for an efficient development. That's obvious because the front end team is totally different from the back end team. So back end team will be only responsible for creating the API URLs or creating the data structure. And similarly, the front end team will be responsible for consuming them and displaying. So the team size should be larger for that. So when should we use Headless Drupal? When the front end teams require full freedom to structure and display the data. That is like we want some interactive pop-ups or shows. Between app-like structure, app-like front end for a awesome website. The front end team does that requires more than one front end consumer system website or multiple apps built at the same time. You just have one API URL and you can have a lot of other apps to consume it. This will protect combined data with multiple distinct API sources like CMS, video management, and social media. The project consists of multiple development teams. So the rest of the services in Drupal. Prior to Drupal 7, we have the services module, services views module, and bookserps resources, which helps us to create Headless Drupal websites. But like as I said, like it was Drupal 7, Drupal 8 is new. But yeah, it was fine, worked fine, it served the purpose. But in Drupal 8, everything is moving to the corner. We have four core modules that helps us create Headless Drupal web services. So first is the RESTful Web Services module, which exposes like whenever you enable it, it will expose the nodes for the in the website, and also you can configure it to expose others like taxometers or users. Serialization is the important one because it provides like in which format you want to expose the services like JSON or XML. HL module extends the serialization module as it provides an extra format, HL JSON, which gives more information about the content. And basic authentication is for it's a basic one, it's not some agenda like authentication, it's a basic authentication whether the user is logged in or so creating vessel. APIs using views in Drupal 8, so it's basically like same views, you know, the views name, descriptions, we are showing content from articles. And this part is provided by the REST module, the RESTful Web Services module. So the URL that you are setting it, REST/export/JSON/articles, the whole URL becomes the API URL whenever the user is the this URL will give you the JSON output or text output. So this is like a pretty basic view structure. So the format was showing it as PPT, but if you show it as PPT, it gives a full view of the entities, like it gives the NIDs, number of comments, everything and all. But also if you want to show specific reads from a content type, it's also possible. Like it's creating these simple basic views in Drupal. And accepted request formats you can use either JSON or XML or if you're using both. So if you have some you can then do it in the browser. When you get the URL, you get a JSON output in the views as selected the ID, the title, body, image, and tags. So it will give the JSON output of the fields that you selected. Now we go to like Angular. Let's say we are using Angular to consume the API. And what an Angular link developer for the modern Malabya outlet. It's just like in the same. So in the first declaring the what type of API, what type of controller that we'll be using. So we are using parameters as a controller name. In the second we are using the specifying the controller name. What the controller should do. The function nodes, scope.nodes, person nodes will give all the nodes that we are getting from the API URL. And the main article list is a function which will give you the list of give the JSON output. So in the second part, we are just hitting the URL by SMTP get request. And we are just returning the response data. And using Angular to consume the link in the HTML part, the first line is the important as the ng-add goes to articles. Articles is the name of the module that we'll be using in the first line. In the script tag, the Angular JS library that will load it, and the article of JS, which is the JS file that we need to load it. And the ng-controller part is the controller that we created in the and ng repeat is like a for loop in Angular. So ng repeat iterates through the nodes that we get, and we get the ID is node.nid and the controller is node.title. So nid.title and .nids are the fields that we get in the JSON. So here I have a Drupal website which has a few contents of type recipes. I have a few taxonomy terms like for SV types. So in the views, I created a view and for recipe types, and I gave the path api/recipe. So if I hit headless.dev/api/recipes, it will give me the recipe types in my website. So in the save for settings, I chose JSON and XML. And instead of entities, I've chosen fields. I want to show the term ID, the name, and the description about the taxonomy term. So this gives me the JSON output of the request. You can also go ahead and if you want to change the field area, some of the fields that you are exposing it. And like I have a description value, but I want to show only description. So if I hit the URL here, it will give me the list of the articles. In the next view, it's a simple view that we are using it. Like we have a argument which is the recipe type, which is the term ID. And here I have the all the recipes which are tagged with 6, the ID 6. So again, like you can have again. And using it with an ID or title as the recipe name. Field is attached to recipe type, then here the what we want to show the field name is field label as well. And there is no coding required at all. And this is the Angular app or Angular website which is consuming it. And this here we will show you all the recipe types that we have in this website. And if you go to snacks, it will display all the snack contents under the website, under snacks. So we created a recipe types module and we created a controller for recipe types, which will call a function get recipe types, which is hitting the URL as headless.webdev/recipes, which will give the JSON output of the recipe types. And the HTML part, we have given the controller as the recipe types name, and the repeat is terms in term and terms, which is we're returning terms. And the next part, that is the to show the contents under the thing. So we have recipes and we have a get recipes. It's the same thing.
When we make a request in HTML,
data URL. There is something called So here we give the URL, and this is the header source. This header is different from the head tag in the HTML. This header will be, we'll be passing it when you are making the API URL call. Yeah. This is for the authentication or for like what type of, usually it tells the what type of application you want to see. If it's a XML, it will be like application slash XML. Like that.
Create
mode. It's the post function. Actually, there are four main operations that is used in web services. That is the create, read, update, and delete. So create is the post. So by which you can use to by which it's same. It's everything is same. Like in post, you have a data parameter. By which will take the what contents you want to post it. You want to create the node. Let's say you want to create an article, you will pass the article the title and the description for the body.
What will be the endpoint?
Same. Like if you want to, like, not same. Every endpoint will be separate, it will be unique for whether it's a get or a post. Post will have their own endpoint. But the parameters will be different. The header parameter and the data parameter will be different for everything.
Sorry? Is there any UA
to create a No. Like, post is not there. Like, by use, we can use a get operation. Thank you.